Hi, my name's Daniel Pemberton. I am the composer to Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, and today I am doing a Reddit AMA, and it's so fancy, I even have a film crew filming it. So I will now look at some of these questions. This is from Fanboy GJ. With how varied and unique each character's theme songs are in ATSV, whose theme song do you think was the hardest to figure out and why? I think Spot's was actually the hardest because Spot's theme has to sort of change and adapt through the film, because Spot starts off as a bit of a goofy character and gets more and more powerful. When I first read the script for this, I had very different ideas for Spot. And I was actually trying to develop this whole kind of sound for Spot based on sort of these synthesized, I don't know how to describe them, called the synthesized bubbles that go, which the best way I can describe them is if you listen to the Jean-Michel Jarre album Equinox, Equinox Part 2 uses them very well. But then they didn't have the bite and the edge that I needed for Spot. So I kind of binned all that after spending a lot of time trying to work out this approach, and then ended up with this sort of sound that was kind of unstable. I realized that that was the way to go because Spot was affected by the collider, and the key to the collider sound, which you kind of hear in the first film and again you hear here, the collider sound is these big string chords that are pulling apart and the orchestra's actually kind of going out of tune and in tune over multiple different instruments to make the sound very unstable. And so in the same way the collider is pulling apart all these kind of matter and molecules, I was trying to do the same with the orchestra. I was like, let's use that approach for Spot. So we have this quite simple bow, bow, bow theme for Spot. But as the film progresses, that becomes more and more discordant and the notes on it become wider and wider apart in pitch as they're played. So there's multiple pitches, but they're more and more out of tune, so it creates a really uncomfortable, discordant feeling. What is the opera singer singing in Italian on Guggenheim Assemble? So I couldn't 100% tell you what he's singing because we made it all up on the spot in the studio. We had an amazing opera singer, and sometimes I like to really write lyrics out. On Steve Jobs, we had this big opera piece, and I got all these lyrics about computers translated into Italian. But on Spider-Verse, I decided we'd make it up on the spot because I wanted to see what vowel from sounds would work best. And we ended up translating Leonardo da Vinci's Wikipedia page into Italian, you're correct. And then we just picked random words out, highlighted them, and then got the opera singer to sing the ones that sounded best. So he's kind of singing about Leonardo da Vinci in Italian, but it probably doesn't make a lot of sense. Who's your favorite Spider-Man? I'm probably very biased in that I would probably say Miles, because he was my first Spider-Man that I ever wrote music for. And also I love Miles, he's so cool and fun. But I would probably say the one I'm closest to is probably Peter B. Parker, in that he's slightly out of shape and getting on a bit. There's a couple of lines in this movie which sadly really resonated with me based on how Peter's physique was doing. A question from OKWeakness1585. Nothing says Reddit has given me my username than that. What makes you want to work solo? By doing the films, you know, pretty much all on my own, I get a kind of fingers over every element of the film, because there's a lot of modern film scores now which are written by a lot more people than one person. There's a kind of industrial complex approach to scoring big films, which I don't have a massive problem with, because big films are very complicated beasts. But I do think when you assign a lot of the writing to assistants and ghostwriters, you lose a sort of freshness and an ability to connect every note of the film to each other, because it becomes a bit more generic and the way people will approach things becomes just solving notes rather than working out how every single thing in this film connects. And I think with Spider-Verse, one of the things that I feel like quite proud of is the fact that every sound and every note really has a connection to every other part of the film. And so it makes the whole universe feel very cohesive, which it probably wouldn't do if a lot of those cues were being done by an army of ghostwriters. They'd all end up just sounding sort of similar-ish. And I also love writing film music. And for me, the greatest joy of my job is actually writing film music and creating it. So I'm just very greedy and want to do it all. Grilled cheese sandwich or toast and honey? I would probably go for toast and honey. But really, my favourite would be Nutella on crumpets. What was the brand of a toilet roll? Because it sparked my interest as an Eastern European. They still use a theme I wrote a long time ago for Lotus toilet rolls in Eastern Europe, and they are adverts featuring a giant bear. I do not get any free toilet rolls, sadly. Groovy Droovy 193. What was my inspiration for Pav's theme? So there's an album which I've talked about a few times called 10 Ragas to a Disco Beat by Chanjit Singh. I might pronounce that wrong. And it's a really amazing album that's very ahead of its time, made in 1982. And it's this Indian guy basically making this crazy electronic album that is the sound of acid house 6 years before acid house kind of existed, with a Indian infusion in the sound. And it had a really cool, futuristic, but also fun energy. And I've always loved that record. And I really wanted to try and take that futurism and fun and give it to Pav, because I thought Pav is a very fun, upbeat character. And I wanted his theme to reflect that. But I also didn't want it to sound like generic Indian music, which can often be the case in these kind of situations of what people think Indian music is. And I always thought this record was a glimpse of a vision, an image of India that doesn't often get heard and seen. What do you think of the Miguel sound effect being used for memes? I like it a lot. Now, I really like the fact that the music you create is being used in a whole different way. In the 80s, you'd write a film soundtrack and it would actually go in the charts. If you look at the charts of like 1981, there is like Ennio Morricone in the chart in the top 10 in Britain, and Vangelis, which is crazy. And that kind of stuff doesn't happen anymore. The new way, I guess, is stuff blowing up on TikTok. You know, we had the Prowler from the first film and Miguel 2099 theme being used from this one, both being like weirdly huge TikTok hits. I always used to use a story of Jaws. What I thought was amazing about Jaws was how John Williams wrote a piece of music that changed forever how people thought of sharks. You could be in a restaurant or anywhere, and you could sort of say to someone, if you asked anyone in this room what a shark would sound like, everyone would probably hum you the theme from Jaws without even knowing who wrote it. And so that little bit of music sort of lives rent-free in all their heads. I like the fact with Miguel, we've kind of created a weird sound effect. I don't even know how you describe it for how people would now describe canon events. No one previously needed a sound for that, but now there is one that exists. So I love it. What are your favorite sample libraries to use? There's a few sample libraries I use for general writing, like Vienna, Sam Symphobia, bit of Spitfire. But my favorite thing to really do is build my own sample libraries. And a very big part of Spider-Verse is years of work building sounds and samples and noises. And I think that's one of the reasons it feels distinctive, is because you can't hear those sounds anywhere else. They're not gonna pop up on another film score or someone else's work. That's a long process, but it's a really rewarding process, because I think the more you can make everything from scratch, the more individual it sounds. In Spider-Verse, another thing we'd do is sample. We'd do a lot of synth jams and resample those jams into sounds, and they would create some of the sort of noises that you hear with all through the score. You know, things like the Go Home Machine had this very nasty, crunchy synth sound. And that was really just messing around on the CS-80, creating loads of weird noises, and then suddenly being like, that bit is really cool, resampling it, and then turning that into an instrument that I can then work with and overlay with, you know, other sounds, strings, percussion. My favorite sample libraries are the ones I make myself. JohnnyBoy666 asks, how did you come up with the idea to have the Anomaly theme be used throughout the movie and the first? Some of the themes in this movie are very straightforward and conventional, and some of them a lot more subtle. The Anomaly idea is kind of based on the whistle, and it's not always true, but as the film progresses, the whistle starts to reflect Miles's status as potentially an anomaly. And we get it in the train chase, really, to foreshadow the moment when we enter Earth 42, and then you really hear it there, and it becomes a kind of a whole sound. And that's just another way to like create all these kind of very subtle connections within the film that maybe the audience doesn't always consciously recognize, but creates a sort of storytelling aspect through the music alone that is telling you part of the story in a way that is less conventional. Pitched Up Prowler from We Go Nerd. Obviously, in Across, there is a big reveal at the end, which I'm assuming everyone here knows, or you wouldn't be on this. But the Prowler returns, but in a slightly different way. And during the sort of research and development phase, one of the things I spent a lot of time on with my fantastic assistant, Alex Grews, was trying to build this time stretch engine. And originally, I was trying to write a lot of the score through this idea of this kind of sample synthesis engine that would stretch time in the same way the spot was stretching dimensions and matter. I had this whole idea of trying to stretch all the music in a very technological kind of way. But it got too messy and didn't work as seamlessly as I wanted it to. But technology that we built was really cool. And so I would throw things into it. And one of the things I threw into it was the Prowler sound. And that means at the end, when you first hear it, when you first see Aaron in Earth 42, the first time he comes up in slow motion, there's a really long, like, sound. And that is the Prowler sound, like, stretched really, really long. And that's quite subtle, whereas later it becomes very obvious. And it was a way of taking a reference in the first film and then transforming it for this new dimension and universe. Sparrow 7075. What was the inspiration between Gwen Stacy's theme in Across the Spider-Verse? Gwen's world in the film has a very distinctive art style, which is quite dreamlike based on the comics, the kind of watercolors, the drips. It's a very colorful world, but with a bit of an emotional edge rather than a very poppy edge. And I wanted to reflect that. I also wanted to have a nod to her playing in a band, and we had quite a lot of discussions about what that band would be. And it was always this kind of like slightly 90s synthy indie pop kind of sound. It took me a while till I could really nail Gwen's theme. Originally, I wanted to try and do all this stuff with female vocals, and it wasn't really working. And then came up with the sound that became like Gwen's sound and the sort of theme for her. And what I loved about that sound was it had a lightness to it and a nimbleness, because I feel, you know, Gwen was a ballerina and can move very quickly and very flexible. And I love the way that theme also has a lightness that I feel is very reflective of her. And so sometimes you just find these things and you're like, okay, that really feels like that reflects that character. And you can find that really quickly, or it takes a long time. And Gwen, it took quite a long time, but as soon as you find it, you're like, okay, great, we've got it. This is from Bumanantix. Who are the composers who inspired you through your musical career so far? So there are many, many composers and pieces of music that have inspired me as a composer. Far too many to mention. But in terms of growing up, I was very early on inspired by electronic music. Started off with people like Jean-Michel Jarre, Vangelis, and Mike Oldfield. Then I went through a phase of being very obsessed with sort of more avant-garde ambient electronic stuff like The Future Sound of London, The Orb, The Grid, Aphex Twin, Brian Eno. Then I got really into The Beach Boys, John Barry. From a film composing perspective, the composers probably had the biggest impact on me is Ennio Morricone, because he approached things in a very exciting and groundbreaking way, which for me is the most exciting way to look at film music as an art form, in that he just took influences from everywhere. So he would write really strong, powerful melodies, but then would also marry them with really intriguing and unexpected avant-garde techniques and sounds and approaches. His body of work is insane, and the sort of musical risks and adventures he took on movies is really mind-blowing when you look back on it. You know, some of those have become so iconic, something like The Good, Bad and the Ugly. It's really hard to actually look at the music of The Good, Bad and the Ugly with a fresh ear and realize how crazy this score is, that someone is pulling together, you know, gun sounds, people shouting, wildlife calls, electric guitars, timpani, strings, and turning it into something completely iconic. And Spider-Verse is probably most indebted to his approach, because I'm also trying to take a lot of different influences and different sounds and approaches and put them all together into, you know, a kind of audio experience that you wouldn't hear anywhere else. And then I think if you look back on some of those other influences, like early on, what I liked about, let's say, someone like Jean-Michel Jarre or Vangelis is they'd often make records that would have a very contained sound for each record. So each record would sound and feel very different. They'd have a kind of palette and they'd work within that. So if you get bored, I recommend checking out Oxygen, Equinox, and Zuluk by Jean-Michel Jarre. You know, there's so many great Vangelis records. Blade Runner is a fantastic one. There's an album called Direct I really like. And all of those records have a sound which changes between each record. And I try and approach films in a similar way, where I try and make a sound world that is unique to that film. So, you know, the sound for Spider-Verse and the sound world I've created for that is very different to, say, the sound world for Enola Holmes or The Bad Guys or Amsterdam or Motherless Brooklyn. Each of those films has a unique sound world. And I think that way keeps me on my toes and keeps me sort of fresh and excited, rather than just doing a generic, here's my sound on each project. Okay, so using synths in scoring, I really like to try and use synths in a way that captures energies and textures you can't get elsewhere. I don't like synth sounds that sound too conventional, and I really don't like using presets. So a big thing for me is trying to program sounds that you've built or tweaked from the ground up, because that way I think they feel more unique to the project. I started off with one synthesizer, which was a Korg WaveStation, which was the first synth I got. And I really, really could program that like crazy, because that's all I had. And now I have too many and I'm not that great at programming any of them. And I think the more you can master a couple of things than be a bit average at tons means you'll get a more distinctive sound. Okay, Long Jumping Raisin 15, my favorite username. Is creative freedom as a composer the real ingredient for the success of Across the Spider-Verse? I would say yes. I think one of the reasons Spider-Verse has been so well received is because it feels different to most other movies out there. And I think it feels different because everyone who was working on that film was given the freedom to be as creative as possible and push those boundaries as far as they could go. For me, cinema is always about the new, and your favorite cinema experiences are always when you see and experience something for the first time. And I think over the last sort of decade or so, a lot of the films we saw felt like reheated moments from the past, and it was losing its impact. And I think one of the reasons people have responded so well to Spider-Verse is when they sit in a dark room, they're seeing and hearing something for the first time that looks and sounds like that. And I'm really conscious of making the most of that and trying to make scores that feel like nothing you've heard before. And the only way you really get to do that is by having a proper level of freedom to be as creative as possible. The sort of park you get to play in with Spider-Verse is one of the most creative arenas you can have as a composer, because there's so much creativity elsewhere in the film. And if you have a film where, you know, the rest of the film is quite traditional, it's harder to really, really push at the edges. But with Spider-Verse, everyone was pushing, and so it made it a lot more exciting and challenging. Spider-Verse, The Peep Show is strange. Did you compose the Pip-Pop plot theme? Yes, I did. I created the music to Peep Show when I was on holiday in Mallorca. I was staying at a cottage that had a well in the garden, and the well had a really good echo, and I had a mini disc recorder, and I plonked the microphone in the well and recorded myself going into the well, and then resampled that, and those noises ended up being the sort of interstitial sound that you hear on Peep Show. And for a long time, even though I'd done loads of films, everyone in the UK seemingly has never seen them. So I'd explain what I do. Oh, you're a film composer. I'd rattle off the films and they'd be like, oh yeah, I didn't see that, didn't see that. And then you'd say, oh, and I also did that noise in Peep Show. And everyone would be like, oh my God. And so I still think maybe that is the thing I'm most famous for, but maybe not anymore. What inspired you to make music? I really loved the way music could create different worlds in your head. You know, two bits of music could take you to two very completely different places in your mind. And I think that's what really got me going, was just creating these kind of landscapes and these universes that could all feel very different. One of the reasons I love making film music is because it allows me to always create new universes. I think when you're in a band, you have to do the same approach over and over again and stick to a similar style, or people get confused. Whereas with being a film composer, you can jump into such different worlds and universes on a really regular basis. So, you know, I love playing in the world of Spider-Verse, but then I can jump into something like Enola Holmes and write something that's a lot more traditional and orchestral and has a different feeling and different emotions. And then, let's say I've just done a film called Ferrari with Michael Mann, and that's got a very different feel to all of those. I like that act of creation. Are there any other Easter eggs that people seem to have missed? Yeah, it depends. Easter eggs are like an interesting word. There are a lot of things hidden in this score, and I like to not always confirm or deny them because it makes it more fun. But I will say that there's a lot of connection between everything in this universe, and I'm very conscious of trying to connect everything. And I think one of the things when you're creating a whole soundscape from the ground up, with Spider-Verse, we are kind of creating our own orchestra. We've got so many sounds and motifs and textures that are unique to this world. They can all be used in ways that reference key moments from each film, and thematics and motifs also do that within the score. Sometimes people think those are Easter eggs, sometimes they're just how you write film scores. But yes, I'm glad that people are spotting a lot of those. Lionman 760, did you sample a goose honk for the track? I heard it the first time wondering what. Yes, in that sequence, we record scratched a goose honk and a bunch of other goose noises. In My Name is Miles Morales, which is the first time we get to sort of revisit Miles in the film, I really wanted to turn that whole sequence into a showcase for DJ Blakey, who did the record scratching all through the first film and this new one. And I wanted to try and scratch as many of the elements you see on screen as possible. So we open with like the Miles preventing a car crash. I used like car crash noises. Then he's in a bunch of fights. We used a lot of the fight noises, scratched those. He's drawing with felt tip pens. We scratched the felt tip pen sounds. Scratched the spray cans. Scratched the Jeopardy bells. And I would basically scratch anything you could on screen to try and make this kind of very unusual texture to the track. And then only when we were recording all this stuff, I was like, oh my God, there's this whole section at the end with a goose. Why aren't we scratching the goose sound? So we got the goose noises. I was like, let's just scratch those. And that was one of my favorite bits of the film, where we just started scratching the noises of the goose. And it works so well. It's such a good sound to scratch. And that ends up being quite a big part of the last half of that track. I wanted to ask, in general, Spider-Man music was almost exclusively orchestral. What inspired you to compose the much more electronic score in the movies? I love orchestral scores, and I love orchestral film scores, but I also love trying to do something new and different. And I felt the approach of Spider-Verse was very groundbreaking, and I wanted the score not to feel like a traditional score. And I think the way I approach most movies is I don't want anything to feel like stuff you've heard before. And for me, there are so many great orchestral, fully orchestral scores out there that I think the way I try and make something feel more impactful is trying to look at the orchestra as just one element of my palette rather than the palette. Sometimes I will give as much importance to a, you know, like a badly recorded whistle sound as I would to a 70-piece orchestra we've recorded at Abbey Road. And I think that approach of looking at everything purely for the sound impact of it and the emotional impact of it rather than the status of the sound, i.e. the status of a huge orchestra in a posh recording studio being more important than something I've recorded on my iPhone, is what makes these scores feel very different, because everything is all mashed up together. The original Spider-Verse, I almost wanted to do all electronically early on because I felt it would feel very different But I then really felt I was losing a lot of the heart that I wanted and the emotion if I did it purely that way. So then I started to introduce the more kind of orchestral elements like strings and brass. And that really gave cohesiveness to the whole experience that was missing. But with Across the Spider-Verse, with Miguel's world, we get to use a lot more electronics because it feels that there's a kind of technological aspect to his universe, and the electronics and the synths really echo that. Negasonic 666. Lots of popular 666 users on this. I don't know what that says about people who like my music. Why did you decide to use animal sounds as part of the sound design of both Spider-Verse movies, and how do you narrow down which animal you wanted to use? I will basically use anything that makes a cool sound or an interesting sound if I can within my scores. So animal sounds have very interesting timbre and connotations to them as well. But really, it doesn't have to just be animal sounds. It can be anything. One of my favorite things is squeaky doors and squeaky gates. And I have infuriated girlfriends in the past by ruining entire holidays by spending 30 minutes opening and shutting very loudly a very squeaky door in an Airbnb. Or if I'm on a walk and I find a squeaky country gate, I can spend a lot of time recording a squeaky gate. Anything is game for me if it can be an interesting sound. And there are interesting sounds everywhere. Again, one of the things I love about Spider-Verse is it's an environment that allows me to pull in those sounds, whether that be the sound like a bird call or an elephant or a squeaky door, and throw that into the soundtrack alongside an orchestra and everything else. Key Flaky 3864 asks, what is your process for getting the sound of a character or moment? How did you decide, for example, what Spider-Man 2099 sounds like? One of the big challenges in Spider-Verse and any film is really how do you distill a character into a sound or a melody that encapsulates them, but also is very recognizable. With Spider-Verse, the film moves at such a pace that you have to come up with motifs that can work incredibly fast and are incredibly recognizable within a second. 2099 came quite early in the process. Probably one of the sort of more early character sounds. And I wanted to get something that had a reference to his world, which I felt was very technologically advanced and futuristic, but also had a kind of ambiguity to it, had a dark threat to it, but it wasn't necessarily threatening. I didn't want to make him too dark. And so the kind of siren-y motif is almost like more of a question than a statement. You know, you get a sound and you're suddenly like, that feels right for that character. And a lot of it is also, how do you get sounds that are going to interact with all the other characters? Because what's really important in Spider-Verse is that every theme and every character theme can interact with the other characters' themes, which is why, you know, by the end of the film, when they're all interacting, it feels quite satisfying for the audience because they're all suddenly all working together as one piece. And then for other characters, they've all got different approaches. Like, one of the themes that doesn't get talked about a lot is Jessica Drew has a kind of sort of cry, which weirdly is actually me sped up through a ring modulator. And again, she, you know, she doesn't have a lot of screen time to establish that. And so again, it's trying to get a sound that will cut through in like half a second. I am an aspiring musician and would love to know about your process of making a theme or cue, your favorite plugins and your DAW. So I work in Logic. I really like Logic. It allows me to be very creative very quickly. My favorite plugins that I use, I probably use a lot of Zebra on Spider-Verse. I use a lot of EXS24 with my own sample libraries put in. Kontakt, where me and my assistant Alex has built some really cool Kontakt sets and complicated Kontakt programmy things. Although I find a lot of the librarian processes in Kontakt absolutely terrible. I love SoundToys plugins. I think they're brilliant. There's a lot of Echo Boy and Devil Lock. Those are probably my favorites. Right, what's your favorite track out of both Spider-Verse scores? Okay, this is not easy, but I would say, weirdly, I think on both of them, it's the final tracks. In the first film, that's called Spider-Man Loves You. The Spider-Man Loves You really is Miles's theme. And all through that film, we've been building the elements of that track as Miles goes on the journey to become Spider-Man. And it's only really at the very end of the film he really becomes Spider-Man. So for me, that's probably my favorite piece on the first album. And then on the second film, Across the Spider-Verse, again, it's the end piece, which is called Across the Spider-Verse, Start a Band. Because again, it's pulling together all the different elements throughout the film into one sort of cohesive final piece. And I also got to go ridiculously big with it. Phil Lord, who was one of the producers and writers on the show, was just like, this needs to just be as big as it can possibly be. And that's my favorite kind of note, where you're kind of just told, just write and just make it as exciting as possible. With that one, I didn't have to hold back. And so that's probably my favorite piece on the album. What elements comprise his sound and his theme? Spot's sound is kind of made up of a couple of elements. One was messing around with a very cool sound on a piece of software that some friends of mine called Slate and Ash, who designed some software for the first Spider-Verse film, and they now build very cool synths. And that's where I started from. And then I used detuned electric cello to make the sound get more and more discordant and uncomfortable as the film progresses. So it's a blend of a kind of slightly wavering pitch synth part and a very discordant electric cello part. What's your favorite bit of weird instrumentation you've got to do thus far? Is there anything you'd be trying to get in there but haven't got the fit yet? On Spider-Verse, my favorite weird instrumentation is the record scratch goose you hear in My Name is Miles Morales. We record scratched a goose over the last half of that piece when Miles and the Spot run into a goose. When you're doing record scratching, you really learn what sounds are good to record scratch and which sounds aren't. And a goose honk is really, really good to record scratch. It sounds so mental. But in other projects, I did a TV series where I wrote a lot of the music on a ruler. I don't know if you remember at school when you're boying a ruler on the side of your desk, but I wrote quite a lot on a ruler because it was based at school. So I used to do that at school, boying a ruler. And I quite enjoyed that. I mean, I always try and put something odd in my scores. For some reason, I quite like to get toilet flushing on one of them. I got snoring in, there was a scene in Birds of Prey, which got cut, which had a security guard who was asleep during this scene where Harley Quinn raided the offices. And I managed to get snoring into that whole sequence as a loop that went round and round and round. But sadly, that scene got cut. But you can hear it on the Birds of Prey album. I was quite proud of that, being the first composer to get snoring in a DC superhero movie. The King Arthur score, I'm very proud of, in that it features a lot of really ridiculous sounds in it, such as someone moving their tuning pegs on the guitar, me breathing, me screaming, me slapping my face, which also features in Spider-Verse. Getting that kind of stuff on a big Hollywood blockbuster, or not blockbuster film in the case of King Arthur, is very exciting because it sort of says you can do anything. It doesn't have to be a big orchestra. Okay, here's a question from Tarwana the Tiger. Tahir the Tiger? Hi Daniel, is there any other movie, TV show, video game that you'd like to be a part of? I'm not going to answer this as a composer. Take this question at face value and a TV show you'd like to be part of. And for some reason I read TV game show, and there used to be a TV show called The Krypton Factor in Britain that had a very good theme tune by The Art of Noise, and they had a really good assault course level on it, and I for some reason would quite like to do that. Random answer. This is from Dirk Demon. Hey Daniel, I hope you're doing well. Hey, thanks very much. I am. I was wondering where the three new bonus tracks are supposed to go in the film if they did make it. During the process of making this film, often we would score scenes many different ways. We'd try different ideas out. There was a lot of experimentation over every scene in this movie. And often those didn't go further than demos, but there were a few cues where we did record them, and there were some where we recorded alternates. So Father and Son, originally written for the scene where Miles and Jefferson, his dad, are talking above Alchemax after defeating, as they saw it, the Spot. Chelsea, New York was originally going at the beginning in Gwen's story after Peter Parker dies, we ended up using the Self-Love Metro track, which is great. So I was like, fine, bin that. But I always quite liked that cue. And it was also the first time we were going to hear Gwen's theme. And then Triumph was a different approach for the very end of the film after Miles gets back to what he thinks is his dimension. And again, it was just a different way of scoring that scene that we actually recorded. There are many, many other cues, other approaches for every scene in the movie that didn't go further than demos. But those are three we actually recorded, and I thought it'd be cool to, you know, stick them out there if people wanted to hear them. What is your favorite score you think is a bit more obscure in your own portfolio? There's a number of scores I feel have been cruelly overlooked. I really like my score to Amsterdam, which was kind of all recorded with woodwinds, and I feel that's a really good listening experience and a really fun album. I really like that. I did a film called Motherless Brooklyn with Edward Norton. It's got a very noir-y jazz feel, which I don't think many people have heard. There was a series called Welcome to Earth that's like me doing a very kind of organic electronic hybrid sound, which is also worth a listen. But if you love the Spider-Verse scores, the best entry points are probably Birds of Prey, again, not listened to enough by people because it's a crazy album. I basically just went nuts in LA and got every musician I could in LA on that record, from opera singers to gospel choirs to rock bands, and that's a really fun score. So yeah, I would suggest that and King Arthur and Man from U.N.C.L.E. as ones that would probably be an easy fit after Spider-Verse. And then if you want to get a bit deeper, Amsterdam, Motherless Brooklyn, Welcome to Earth, that'll do. Stab Man, not a good name in London. Hi, what would you say are the most important skills a person must have to become a movie composer? I would say being a movie composer is not just about writing music. I think a lot of people think you just write the music and that's it. But there's so many other things you have to deal with. Politics within a film, psychology of how to convince people that your ideas are good, listening to other people's ideas. It's a very collaborative process film, and everyone has their own, you know, view on how it should work, and it's really important everyone works together as a team. I think you've got to be a bit of a car salesman. It is probably more important than it should be in terms of how you sort of sell your ideas, and you've got to be incredibly nimble at rewriting things, coming up with brand new ideas on the spot. You've got to have incredibly thick skin, because you will get a lot of crap thrown at you. One director once said, I had the thickest skin of any person he'd ever met, which was sort of a compliment, but basically because he was giving me a lot of shit. You just got to have a kind of resistance and an ability just to keep going no matter what gets thrown at you. And then you can hopefully write a good film score. Creating the character themes across Spider-Verse was probably one of the biggest challenges early on, really trying to nail the sounds and the melodies that would feel right for them. Once you've got it, it feels very straightforward, but the process to get there takes a long time. I mentioned this somewhere else, but you know, early on with Gwen, I tried all these themes with female vocals. They didn't really work. Spot, I tried a bunch of ideas with kind of crazy synthesizer sounds that didn't really work. Miguel came pretty early on. One of the things that's cool about that is it meant I could start putting that theme into the trailers, and which again was important for me because I could go off on a whole rant about trailer music and the way companies really do not understand the power of using music from the film in a trailer early on, because it allows the audience to have a connection with a sound and a theme before they've even gone into the movie. So when they go into the movie, they've already experienced it a bit, which means when it lands, it's way more exciting. And so luckily we got to do that with Miguel. When you come up with the themes for a character, you know when it doesn't work and when it does. And it's just a sort of instinctual feeling. And sometimes I will push along with a theme that is maybe not working to see whether it starts to fit. And then you're just like, no, and you have to bin it. But eventually you can come up with something that's very simple and it really works. And it's great. And it's, you know, it's very satisfying when that happens. The other thing is every character's theme should feel different to everyone else's. And so if you have characters' themes that feel too similar, they're not going to stand out when they all combine at key moments. So that again is complicated. We can see the notes in the original Spider-Man theme, in Gwen's theme, and even Miles's. Are there any other hidden details like this in the characters' themes? Most of the characters' themes are based around a similar harmonic language, so everything can connect. There are some other hidden details, but the more mysterious I am about them, the more fun it is. Da-da. Right, thank you very much for sending in all those questions, and I hope I answered some of them okay-ish. Thank you.